Airing first on Asheville FM, WSFM LP 103.3 in Asheville, this is The Final Straw Radio, a weekly anarchist and anti-authoritarian radio show broadcasting out of occupied Soligi land in southern Appalachia. We bring you voices and perspectives from projects and struggles all around the world. We're happy to be sharing the second half of this conversation with Graham Clumpner, anarchist, U.S. military veteran, and eco-defender. If you missed the first half of this chat, check out our May 17th episode up at our website. For this hour, Graham talks about the responsibility of U.S. society as a whole for the devastation of the global war on terror and to the victims of Afghanistan, Iraq, and elsewhere. He also talks about the need for a movement against militarism and the war, the need for active inclusion of veterans into our movements and intersections of militarism and ecological devastation and climate catastrophe, and how to push back and try to reverse it through direct action. The Final Straw Radio is a proud member of the Channel Zero Network of Anarchist Podcasts, and here's a jingle from another member of CZN.
Hey everybody, my name's Eamon, and I'm the host of a show on the Channel Zero Network called Radical People. And wouldn't you know it, we're going into the third season. It's a monthly show, so it's really not hard to get extra seasons. But anyway, basically, it's a show in which I interview people who are involved in direct action or direct action campaigns, past or present, and we hear their great stories. Anyway, it's on the Channel Zero Network, it's on iTunes, and I'm sure at this point you know how to find a podcast. Radical People. Check it out.
So what do you think is the responsibility of veterans to make amends for the harms that they've done to people abroad? And you mentioned like people pumping gas or you know, people flying drones and maybe not the people that were kicking in doors or whatever, but how much is that responsibility also shared by the taxpayers more generally who continue funding the machine that does that and sending our brothers and sisters and children abroad?
Yeah, it's, you know, there's a lot of anger among the military community and the veterans community that there's this idea that we're the ones who made a choice to go do this. And then so thus we're the ones who are guilty. And we're the ones who did these crimes. And I'm sorry, but you know, every one of us needs to point the finger at ourselves. We didn't, you know, those of you who were out there in the streets in 2001, you failed. You failed to stop the war. It doesn't, you know, there's no second place you know, participation trophy for failing to stop, you know, the deaths of over 2 million Iraqis and hundreds of thousands of Afghans and countless others. Like that blood is on all of our hands. You know, to use the United Nations framework on climate change, you could say there are common but differentiated responsibilities. So, yes, I raised my right hand and I volunteered. I made that choice. Now, I made that choice as a 17-year-old. You know, we generally agree, those of us who like and believe in science, we generally agree the brain doesn't develop until you're 25, 26. So maybe on some level there's a pass for some of us who joined very early on. But look, the majority of the military is made up of 19, 20, and 21-year-olds. It's not made up of like adults. The adults in this country are still, unfortunately, the baby boom generation who claimed to lead the revolution out to the communes in the 1970s, and then they abandoned the revolution along with their communes. And then they came back and they created the neoliberal state we're now in. They elected George Bush president, and if they had elected Al Gore president, maybe there's some differences, maybe not Iraq, but we're still, you know, we're still an empire. We're still doing this damage on some level. So really, to me, there's a collective responsibility. And what that means is not, I'm not saying all of you should feel guilty. I'm saying that you should get out and fucking organize, that we have a lifelong accountability process with the people that whose lives we've destroyed. Well, let me tell this story. One of the first times I drove outside, we get into Afghanistan, I drove off of base and we're, you know, driving in a convoy of trucks. And I'm like wet under the ears, excited. I'm here to save people. This is 2004. I'm gonna make a difference. And I remember we were driving through this very, very tiny village, maybe 1,000 people in it. And I see, you know, we're cornering at like 50 miles an hour. We're driving through this village way too fast, but we're doing it because we don't want to get shot at or blown up, right? And I remember seeing this young kid, maybe 5, 6, 7 years old, standing in the corner. And I slowed down a bit and I put my arm out to wave at him. And he just sticks his hand up and puts his middle finger out at me. And I just remember being so crushed. Like, I was like, I'm here to help you.
That's like, the least he could have done.
And, you know, we terrorize an entire population for generations. Like, that generational trauma is going to be, those stories are going to be told, and that hatred is going to exist for us, and we can't do anything to undo that. But if there were Russian troops on our streets doing what we did to Iraqis and Afghans, I guarantee you the vast majority of us would be throwing Molotov cocktails and shooting them, and it wouldn't matter if we were anarchists, communists, socialists, right-wing Nazis, or the Republican and Democratic Party. Well, I'm sure the Democrats would collaborate with them, but the rest of them would fight back. And you know, when I realized that, I was like, you know, flip the script, flip the story. Let's make this Washington State instead of Kabul, and let's make, you know, instead of it's the Americans occupying, it's the Russians or it's the Chinese or whatever, North Koreans, as if that's possible. You know, and the flip side is true. And it became impossible for me to hate these people, who many of which were just defending, in their minds, they were defending their homes and trying to protect themselves and their families. And, you know, so for when I'm talking to the Americans, I still have, you know, a lot of anger and frustration because, you know, people on the right, not so much anymore, but people on the right will thank me for my service and, you know, have some assumptions about what I did. I somehow like protected their freedom or some fucking insane, you know, getting thanked at the gas station or whatever. It's just like, what the fuck? And then people on the left don't want to acknowledge it. It's like somebody took a poop in your Fruit Loops. It's just like, oh, let's avoid that. And then so neither of our sides, if there are sides in this country, are really able to come to grips with the impact of these wars that they've had on our culture. I mean, you want to wonder what the media is now going through, this constant process of wondering why they're not trusted. Well, because they fucking sold us the biggest lie in American history. Hook, line, and sinker. We bought into Iraq and nationalism based on a lie, and our media sold that to us. And they continue to sell us shit, you know, and there's a reason the right wing has been empowered by this. There's a reason that reactionary politics and populist politics are sweeping the nation. And until we come to grips with what we've done as a collective society, whether or not we supported the war, whether or not we were out marching or fighting or doing blockades, we're all responsible for it. And I don't have any easy answers of how we undo that, but I do think, like I started this episode with, I do think there's just a part of shutting up and listening to people on all sides of the conflict. You know, I worked on a project a number of years ago. It was very short lived, but it was called the Frontlines Project. And what we did was we brought Afghan veterans and Afghan civilians to Canada, and we brought American and Canadian soldiers to Canada. And we called it the Occupiers and the Occupied. And we did this tour throughout the country and stopped at a number of different universities and bars and restaurants and places. And we sat on stage together and we healed in front of crowds together. It wasn't the intention. We just originally thought we were just like, let's talk about stuff and it'll be compelling and maybe like people will pay attention to the anti-war movement, right? But really what it turned into was like this almost this public healing process where we learned, you know, I was able to tell the Afghan women, especially on the stage with me, like what it was like to be on one side of the door, and they were able to tell me what it was like to be on the other. And there's trauma on both sides of that door, that proverbial and literal door that's being kicked in. And that's it, you know, I think a lot of the times in the left, we do this pyramid of oppression, which is, you know, in my opinion, it's a really poor attempt at addressing these underlying traumas that, like, you know, like I said earlier, my experience is my experience and your experience is your experience. And like trying to compare it or measure it or like, you know, against each other is just not that helpful. When really trying to heal from the trauma, and when we can start to understand that there are systems that are bigger than ourselves, and there are people with names and addresses that have chosen to do this to us, like people in the ruling class, people who very, very small amount of people who directly and continuously benefit from keeping us divided against each other. That's when we're going to heal as a community, as a culture, as groups of people, is when we actually, as Immortal Technique says, point the gun at the real motherfucker. Proverbially.
Yeah, of course. Hypothetically. So at the time that you joined the military, it was, as you said, like an extraordinary time that if you weren't alive in the U.S. at the time, maybe, like, you probably can't imagine just how many fucking yellow ribbons there were and how long it took to rip all of them down from the street. But, like, it was at a rare level of national fervor and bloodlust that you haven't seen outside of Pearl Harbor and maybe sometimes during, like, Korea and Vietnam or during those wars. But it's led to two occupations that are still ongoing, plus increased operations throughout the rest of Asia and Africa. What would you say to someone who's thinking about joining the military at this time? Like, you mentioned the economic draft. There's a lot of reasons that somebody is coming out of, like, a bad house, out of problems with drugs. Maybe it's someone who is, like, looking to actually, they're undocumented and they're looking to get on the road towards citizenship in the U.S. Someone who's looking to defer some criminal charges. What would you say to them, or what would you say to someone who loves them and cares about them to try to dissuade them from making that choice to join the occupation army?
Well, I'm not going to have an easy answer for you. And I think this is I'll start with a larger problem that we have as revolutionary movements, which is that we do a very, very poor job of offering alternatives. We do a great job of identifying the bad guys, what the problems are, great analysis, probably a legacy of Marx in that, but we don't identify alternatives, and whether those are economic alternatives or whether those are community-based alternatives. One of the things that you had mentioned before was just indigenous participation in the military. Like, one of the common misconceptions based on the Vietnam War is that the military is full of black and brown people, overwhelmingly based on the per capita numbers in the United States. Not true, actually. Not true for black and brown folks, with the exception of Native American. White members of the military white males make up around 77% of the U.S. military. However, Native Americans are 400% overrepresented. What I mean by that is they make up about a percentage of the American population, and they make up a little over 4% of the active duty military. I work with a lot of indigenous communities out here in the Cascadian Salish Sea region, and for a lot of people, like you said, escaping systemic oppression there's not a lot of options, and when you're offered three squares and a cot and some way to get out of whatever difficult situation you're living in, I unfortunately have to say that the military is one of the few options for many people. So I think there are degrees of, there's no black and white answer, but what I would say is there's degrees of ways that you can provide a safer opportunity for somebody to live through it and have less trauma, or to avoid it altogether. So I would start with, actually genuinely listening to the young person about what they want, not what they think the military is necessarily going to be like, but asking them, like, what their goals are and what they their image and their story that they think they're participating in, and then putting them in contact with other veterans that have been through that and can talk to them. But I will also say that had you done that with me as a 17-year-old, and my parents tried, I wouldn't have listened. We all remember how stubborn we were as teenagers. Like, we thought we knew everything about the world and it was going to be different for us. And often people need to have that experience themselves to get it. But I do think, if young people are, for example, the patriotism part is really hard. If you have somebody who's, like, really wants to do it because they're patriotic, you're going to have a tough time. But if they're doing it because they want college or job security or some skills, or they want to get out of a traumatic situation, I think there's some stuff there that you can work with, helping people understand that there are other options. Not many. We live in late stage capitalism, and, the social safety net is one that is very difficult to access for most of us. So it's not like you can say, well, instead of getting your college or your healthcare here, why don't you do this? Well, those options don't exist for people that are already on the lowest rung of society. And the military preys on class. The military doesn't have a lot of recruitment centers in Inglewood, Colorado. They have recruitment centers in Watts, California. They have them in places where people are already working class and poor. for good reason. They know what they're doing. So I think information is always important. I think telling the truth is always important. But I also think like listening to these young people, actually treating their desires and their fears seriously. You know, we often treat kids very poorly in this culture. And obviously they don't have constitutional rights until you're 18. So, you know, treating a young person as the same way you would treat an adult can go a long way to winning trust with them. And so, you know, again, not just with veterans, and but all people, if we can find a better way of listening to each other, it doesn't mean you're violating your morality because you missed an opportunity to tell them the history of war crimes in the U.S. military. No, but you are building trust with someone to try to understand their motivations. And perhaps, you know, I met many people who were manipulated by recruiters. You know, if you want to run a campaign, there's a good place to start. There's a recruitment center in almost every community in this country. Take your protest there, you know, go and directly intervene in the process of youth manipulation that's happening. And not all recruiters are bad people. They're people who are trying to make careers out of the military, and it's required of anybody who does like a 20-year stint in the military. So they're not necessarily bad humans, but the actions that they're taking are destroying our communities, and it's okay for you to go hold them accountable and to make that publicly known. You'll also get a lot of pushback from the far right. There have been incidences where, you know, gun-toting yahoos go and stand outside recruiting offices with ARs and pretend to defend them from the likes of hippies or something. But I think listening is the best thing I could say. But, you know, here's the wider thing. I stopped organizing in the anti-war movement because we didn't have a movement. And that is not in any way a critique of those who continue to fight in that movement. I'm proud of the friends and family and communities that I've worked with and met in that anti-war fight. But we need a movement that involves all from immigrant justice and feminism to climate and anti-war work. These movements need to stop dividing and start working better together collectively. And, you know, there is intersectionality. We've come a long way, but we're going to abolish war when we take the profit out of war. We're not going to abolish war because we convince enough young people not to join. As long as there's economic inequality and Lockheed Martin makes our number two pencils and our bombs, they're going to continue to exist. So the way that we prevent the next generation of veterans from existing is that we take power and we disperse it fundamentally differently than we have in human history. And I know that's not a easy answer. I'm sorry. I wish I had a better one, but revolution is my answer.
Totally heard.
Rock and roll music is the main weapon.
Of a riot, a storm, lacking the function, the form, far from the normal, follow like cattle, I'm more like the catalyst, calm in the mix of battle, let the cowboy on the saddle, you don't know a missile from a gavel, paratroop trooper flipping loops to death, want innocent flesh, but I'm back in the sight from my foes and friends, with the force and the plan against the line I won't throw in the bed, set a curse of murderous men, in suits of professionals who act like animals, man-child, ruthless and wild.
Left, on the left, left, right, left, on the left, on the left, on the left, 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 left, on the left
twisted tongue. Poor lined up to kill in desert slums for oil and boil beneath the desert sun. Now we speak flame, flip this game. All the targets are taking aim. All targets are taking aim. We're the targets are taking aim.
I think that the approach that you've been taking by focusing on the ecological impact, which is something that people can rally around very easily, and then also integrating in, like, and militarism does this for the ecology, like, is an interesting and useful, like, approach to integrating those, because they definitely interact. But before moving on to questions about, like, Mosquito Fleet and such, I was wondering if you could, for a lack of movement, but there are resources that are out there, and I'm wondering if there are any specific institutions that we haven't named already that you'd like to point people to in case they are looking for a place to ask questions of someone who has experience in the military or experience with de-enlistment, somebody maybe who has signed up and is rethinking this decision that they've made, like how they can get themselves out of that situation before it becomes contractual, that sort of stuff?
Yeah, so just first and foremost, recruiters will lie to you, just like the cops. They will lie to you. They have every right to do so. They're trying to get a quota of a certain amount of people recruited per month so that they stay in their job. And I would also add, as an aside, that recruiters actually have one of the highest suicide rates of any jobs in the military.
Oh, damn.
Because of how much pressure is on them to produce new recruits for the military. You know, so it's often thought that the door kickers and the special operators are the highest suicides, but in fact it's drone pilots and it's recruiters for a whole host of fascinating regions. So I think there's a couple of groups that I mentioned, the GI Rights Hotline. You can call 1-877-447-4487, or you can just look up GI Rights Hotline if you're active duty, or if you are a veteran, you can call them and they can help connect you with people. If you've enlisted in the military, meaning you don't have a college degree necessarily, you're not going to be an officer, you have around 6 months from the time you join that you can actually get out of your contract without negative repercussions the rest of your life. And many people don't know that. They think once they sign the dotted line, it's over. It's not. Many, many people get injured in training at the initial stages, or they just don't, you know, failure to adjust. It's actually a military term they use. It's like, yeah, I failed to adjust to the trauma. So there are a whole host of things I would take a look at. If you've been in the military for a while and you've gone AWOL, which is away without leave, it can be a major problem if you don't get the right help. But there are lawyers out there that can help you. There's hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of soldiers and veterans who have gone through that process and found ways to get out of it. You know, once you're in the military, you can also go through a conscientious objector process, which is basically like making the case that your morality, your guiding light or star, whether that's religious or personal, has informed you that you actually can't take life or you can't participate in the taking of life. And that applied to a whole host of folks. If you are getting out of the military, or you've gotten out and you got an other than honorable or a dishonorable discharge, meaning that your commanding officers felt like you didn't do the best job that you should have, there are ways to change that discharge. There are ways to get you the benefits that you were promised by the American people when you raised your right hand. Again, you can call the GI Rights Hotline for a lot of that. You can also go to Courage to Resist. Just Google that, and that organization still has a lot of resources online. Iraq Veterans Against the War is now called About Face. They do a lot more education and some activism, and you can find them on the internet. And also, if you're a veteran and you're out of the military, but you want to find a community that is not a right-wing community, then you can find Veterans for Peace. They have chapters all over the country, and you can be a member if you're a civilian. You can also support these movements in ways you don't have to be a soldier or a veteran to do so. And I, again, would just go back and say to any civilians that are wondering how they can help or help integrate veterans into social movements, which we need to do, you know, starting with the listening is important, and showing that you're in it for the long haul, that you're actually interested in building a relationship with this person, that you can be trusted. Because if there's any common experience from people in the military around trauma, trauma comes from a betrayal of trust. So there's trust in an authority figure, and that trust is betrayed. And you in the movement are going to have to demonstrate that you are worthy of trust from veterans to have them participate in your movement. And the flip side of it is that veterans are going to have to work hard to check some of the patriarchal and institutional messages that they've been, I don't ever use the term brainwashed, but I would say indoctrinated into and have been trained into. So I would ask of those people in movements working with veterans, please, please, please try to exercise patience. You know, these things aren't as black and white as we are choosing to behave this way. We are trying to heal and find our way through a very muddy past that we have a lot of questions about. And you don't have to fix us, but you can provide a safe place for us to make mistakes. And I'll say this, when I joined the anti-war movement, I was so fortunate in 2009 to somehow land in rooms of people that never called me out in the middle of a room or attacked me for saying the wrong word or not using a gender pronoun properly or not knowing the history of certain movements. People took me aside and they talked to me and they said, hey, you know, you're not the problem, but this behavior that you're doing is hurting other people. Can you alter it? And they did that by building a relationship with me and trust with me, so that when I learned that, for example, making rape jokes, which is very common in the military, was hurting people that I had a relationship with, that I loved and cared about, I immediately stopped. If I had been called out in the middle of a meeting and embarrassed or shamed, I would have walked the fuck out of there and my life would have been fundamentally different. And I know that's really hard for a lot of us to do, and we've all got trauma from different backgrounds, but the more we can exercise patience and understand that we're all stuck in this shitty world together, the more we're going to make a beautiful world out of it. So go to those organizations, support them economically if you can, if you got some extra money. And I would just make a pitch that there's a reason why it's important to have veterans in your movements. We don't have a lot of successful models of revolution in human history where the military or veterans were not a part of it. When you want to win power or you want to take down the dictator or you want to shift power relations, you have to get defection of a significant amount of those who hold the guns. And I don't mean the militias. I mean the active duty and military personnel. You need to find a way to make a case to them that the thing that they're trying to defend is you. And they, you know, to get their finger off that proverbial trigger, that literal trigger that's pointed at you, when you're able to make that case, you saw it in Egypt, you know, with the so-called Arab Spring, when the military started defecting or refused to show up, that's when the power shifted. You know, and when the military took back control, that's when the power shifted back. And so, you know, I think it's hard for us in the left in our small little niches to sacrifice our morality. You know, it feels like we're sacrificing our morality or something. But that purism is getting in the way of us actually building a multiracial, multigendered, powerful movement that can actually not just like abolish the bad stuff, but build something more beautiful. And we veterans have a hell of a lot of skills to bring to bear. You know, the work I do now, I couldn't do without veterans helping me out. We do direct action work that's able to get done because, you know, a lot of the military people, they show up on time. They have their gear already squared away. They know what they're doing. They're willing to put their bodies on the line and take risks to protect other people. These are some of the positive things that can come out of military training. And you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. I think you have to find a way to work with the world as it is.
So you mentioned participation of indigenous folks being such a high percentage of of the military. And it's the U.S. military's first victims were, of course, those communities across Turtle Island. And the legacy of this is celebrated in the culture of the military in the U.S. to this day. Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz points to some examples of this in her An Indigenous People's History of the United States, including the continued use of the phrase, quote, in country, unquote, as a description for operational territory for the military, which is short for Indian country. It's also worth noting that there's a long legacy, as we both mentioned, of Indigenous participation in the military. And I kind of wanted to counterpoint this, though, with the veteran participation in support of the struggle at Standing Rock Sioux and other peoples against the Dakota Access Pipeline in 2016, 2015. And it was a really, really inspiring moment, at least to see from where I was at. And it really troubles the kind of settler colonial heritage of veterans in the U.S. Can you talk a little bit about some of the ways that veterans visibly use their cachet to challenge narratives and to put their bodies on the line?
Yeah, I think it's, I mean, that was an amazing moment. You know, I think that honestly in the media, that was the moment where it shifted. It was not the tropes and narratives that they generally use against the left, or they just ignore us. But it's harder to ignore when we have lionized and created this really false sense of hero worship of the military, when those very people stand up and say, no, this is not okay, it rips apart the rights narrative. It tears it apart at the seams. And I think there's a significant amount of people who join the military for what they believe are good reasons. They believe they're defending their communities. They believe that they're helping other people. Now, where they have, personal responsibility to me, where I get frustrated is when they've had those experiences, they've seen the traumas and the actual effects of our behavior of empire, and they refuse to do anything about it. That's when I get pissed at veterans. But I do think there's a significant amount of people who tried to do the right thing. And so what we saw at Standing Rock was a lot of people, even the likes of Wesley Clark, who's, you know, straight up a continued supporter of war crimes overseas, was still able to stand there and say that he was a general during the Kosovo invasion. And he was still able to say that, you know, the things that the United States government did to the Standing Rock Sioux and to many other indigenous communities in the genocide in the 1800s and continuing to this day were wrong, and asking for forgiveness. You know, I think that takes a lot of vulnerability, and especially for masculine raised people in this country, that's a very difficult thing to do. And so we need to embrace that whenever we do see it. You know, we often said in the anti-war veterans community that we're both the oppressor and the oppressed. And again, not to measure the degrees of it, but like on the one hand, we are doing this violence to other people psychologically and physically, but that doing that violence does damage to you as well. Of course, there are some small exceptions. There are people who are sociopaths and they don't feel anything, but they're a very small amount of the total population. And those of us who have been forced or ordered or even willingly participated in destruction and damage of other people, a part of us is taken from us. I had a friend, Jacob George, who was an amazing musician. He took his own life. He's a veteran, 3 tours in Afghanistan. He took his own life a number of years ago. And you should all go look him up on Spotify or your music thing, Jacob George. But he's an incredible musician, an incredible human. And he used to talk about how every single time he woke up in the morning over there, it took a part of his heart, took a piece of him away. And, you know, those of us who haven't lost all of our hearts and are still able to do something with the time we have left, there's a major power in saying, you know what, America, you want to give us all of this righteous legitimacy? Well, we're going to throw it back in your face and tell you the reality, tell you the brutal truth. There have been, more often than not, veterans participate in leftist movements, just as people. They don't like out and out say like, hey, I'm a vet first, right? So there's probably people in your community and in your work that you don't even know are veterans, that they don't talk about it. But when we do identify ourselves as veterans and stand up, I mean, I think, you know, I remember in 2008, one of the most powerful actions I've ever been a part of was at the DNC in Denver, Democratic National Committee, when they were nominating Obama. We led a march of about 50 veterans in front of, 15,000 people. And we walked from a convention center down to where the president was speaking that, or the future president was speaking that day. And we demanded an audience with one of his staffers to be able to deliver a letter that he was to sign, the president or future President Obama was to sign, committing himself to the complete withdrawal of American forces from Iraq and Afghanistan. And of course, we were unable to get in the convention center because a line of riot cops prevented us. And when we got to that point, you know, some members started speaking on microphones to the police and telling them about who we were and why we were there as veterans and what kind of commitment we made and what kind of oath we swore. And we had riot cops crying and literally being removed from the line by the police because they couldn't fucking rely on them to do their jobs. And so there is a level, what's really happening there in the deepest level is that those cops felt a connection. They saw another human being where in their regular work, they don't see human beings. They see the other, they see criminals, they see hippies, they see anarchists. They don't see a human being. And we force them for a brief moment to see another human being. And the more that we can do that without compromising our mission as activists or our success of a campaign, the more that we can do that and make them see us as human beings, the more successful I believe we're going to be. And I will say one aside, because in anarchist communities specifically, I've run into a number of folks who have identified cops and soldiers as essentially the same thing. And I want to be very, very clear. They are not the same thing. It's one thing to enlist in a national military based on some narratives about liberating people. It's another thing for a temporary period of time, for 3, 4, 5 years to enlist. It's another thing entirely to do policing of your own communities for a career, for your lifetime. And the way that I always explain this is look back through history. Every single war has had veterans of those wars reject the wars themselves, question the wars themselves, form organizations and revolutionary movements to overthrow the ability to do war again. Every single war has had those people in it. There's not a single organization you can find anywhere on this planet of former police who say, you know what? Being a police officer, not the best thing I ever did. Or, yeah, we should abolish the police. I've never seen it. There's a few cops who are like, oh, maybe we were a little bit too rough at the WTO. But there is no institution of former police saying, let's abolish the police force. So I really think it's important that we make those distinctions because I don't organize cops. I don't think that they're worth organizing. I don't think they're part of the working class. I see them as like enforcers of property and of the ruling class, and I think they should be treated as such. And if they want to quit and walk away and join us, then sure, we'll welcome them. But until I actually see evidence of that, we'll continue on the way we are. But veterans and soldiers defect all the fucking time. I mean, if you go back to Cambodia in 1973, Nixon tried to invade Cambodia from Vietnam, and thousands of American soldiers refused. They just fucking refused. In Vietnam, they were like, nope, not doing it, not going to go. And he couldn't do it. That's why we bombed Cambodia from planes, because we couldn't. Nixon couldn't rely on the American troops. That is, you know, a legacy that we many, many times over has happened. And we don't tell those stories. We need to tell them.
He said, son, have you seen the world? Well, what would you say if I said that you could? Just carry this gun, you'll even get paid. I said that sounds pretty good. Black leather boots, spit shine so bright. They cut off my hair, but it looks alright. We marched and we sang, we all became friends as we learned how to fight. A hero of war, yeah, that's what I'll be. And when I come home, they'll be damn proud of me. I'll carry this flag. 'cause it's a flag that I love and a flag that I trust. I kicked in the door, I yelled my commands. The children, they cried, but I got my man. We took him away, a bag over his face, from his family and his friends. They took off his clothes, they pissed in his hands. I told them to stop, but then I joined in. We beat him with guns and batons, not just once, but again and again. A hero of war, yeah, that's what I'll be. And when I come home, they'll be damn proud of me. I'll carry this flag to the grave if I must, 'cause it's a flag that I love and a flag that I trust. She walked through bullets and haze. I asked her to stop, I begged her to stay, but she pressed on. So I lifted my gun and I fired away. And the shells jumped through the smoke and into the sand that the blood now had soaked. Collapsed with a flag in her hand, a flag white as snow. A hero of war, is that what they see? Just medals and scars, so damn proud of me. And I brought home that flag, now it gathers dust, but it's a flag. Son, have you seen the world? Well, what would you say if I said that you could?
So I'd like to talk a little bit about the ecological work that you do and the connections that you draw between, not just you obviously, but like between militarism and ecological devastation. You mentioned before, like, talking to a conservative, like a hypothetical conservative, and saying, you're not doing your like patriotic duty by supporting the generals. The generals know that climate change is happening. Like, they work and they plan around this thing. But I'd like to hear about what sort of impact the American military machine has on, you know, ecological systems around the world, besides just the bombs blowing up in certain places, and also the sort of direct action work that you personally are involved in.
Yeah, so the U.S. military is just by and large the largest emitter of carbon dioxide and CO2 into the atmosphere. There's no other nation state that comes close. The U.S. Navy in and of itself is the biggest. So, you know, you got to build bases, right? What are bases made of? They're made of concrete, and concrete is one of the biggest emitters of carbon dioxide in the world. You got to fly jets. They're using JPL, which is jet fuel, and that's incredibly carbon intensive. You know, you've got to transport troops. You've got to, that requires diesel, because most of our vehicles in the military run on diesel. So there's like an exorbitant amount of energy that is utilized by the military just for basic operations. And we're not even talking of like what depleted uranium does to the soil or to humans for that matter. We're not talking about the bombs. We're talking about just a simple function of maintaining a military force in the United States, which is the largest on the planet. You know, we spend more than the next 7 or 8 countries combined on monetarily. So any kind of attempt to address climate change, it needs to address militarism. And this is a major problem within our liberal intelligentsia, the 350s of the world. And I have plenty of friends who work at 350 and Sierra Club and all that, and they're all great. And they just got nailed pretty hard by Michael Moore's new movie, so I understand they're a little gun shy right now. But look, the climate movement especially needs to get its act together and have a black and white line in the sand when it comes to opposing foreign wars, period. And domestic ones for that matter. But like, if we're going to have any attempt at addressing climate catastrophe, then we need to start with the military. One of the reasons that I don't believe in individual change is because you can ride your bicycle your entire fucking life or walk everywhere and eat vegan and do all the right things. Lockheed Martin and Boeing in the last 5 seconds did more than your entire life combined. And so we really need to be thinking about these things in terms of systems. That doesn't mean that it's not helpful for you to make personal choices for your own health or your own political legitimacy when you're talking about these things. Yes, that's helpful. But please don't just delude yourself to think that you're somehow having some sort of systemic effect on society when you have no approach to ending militarism in our society. And militarism pervades everything. It pervades the police. It pervades the stories we're told in school about who we are as Americans. It's clearly coming out in the COVID-19 crisis. You can just see all of these people who are, straight up showing up with weapons to to
liberate
protest
the city halls.
Their right to be able to go to the gym, which is like, dude, just get a gym at home. Like, it's not that fucking hard. But, there are narratives and a lot of people since 9/11 have really begun to identify themselves as more militaristic than they've ever been before. And, playing soldier, doing the LARPing of being a super soldier. And it was really interesting, actually, just as an aside, but with the recent wonderful little mission that happened into Venezuela, where a couple of like 3X soldiers and a bunch of Venezuelan mercenaries tried to abduct the president of Venezuela. There were so many comments among the veteran community online where people were like, hey, if you want to do the real thing, like you clearly failed to do the masculine thing by joining the army and being successful. So you went off and played war on your own. And of course, there's tons of it's problematic to say that, but like, there is an identity problem in this country where men don't have any alternative to seeing themselves as men, but to do violence to other people or to look like they're strong enough to do violence to other people. It's a sickness that we need to address. But when it comes to climate change, for me, there was two things that really pushed me. One was that when I served in Afghanistan, one of the major problems we had was there was a significant drought that lasted almost a decade. Afghanistan used to produce some of the best wine in the world, and it produced cereal grains, so a significant amount of the cereal that you eat in the mornings, your Special K to your Post cereals, they all used to come from Afghanistan. And people were able to grow. It was a very, the Indus Valley region is the oldest settlement in human history that we know of, and that's right on the Afghan-Pakistani border. But that drought led to crops dying. But one of the things that didn't die was poppy. Poppy requires 5 times less water than conventional cash and food crops. And so people began to grow poppies, not because they wanted to support a heroin addiction in the United Kingdom, but because they believed that was the way to feed their family. They couldn't even find the United Kingdom on a map, let alone know that it existed, but they're sitting there trying to feed their family. And what the NATO coalition that was occupying Afghanistan did is try to destroy the poppy fields and go after. So once you start destroying people's ability to feed themselves, guess what? They pick up a rifle and they start shooting back. And so I saw this like, somewhat convoluted line, but you could trace the line from the drought to the insurgency. And while it wasn't the only reason that people were fighting back, it was a major reason that motivated day-to-day people to pick up arms. And now you see it in Syria. You see that the drought helped destabilize the country, plus 1.5 million refugees from Iraq coming across the border, destabilized all of the welfare and social systems that the Syrian government, as bad as it is, had for people, which led to anger and unemployment, and people began to rise up. And then the military started to shoot people. And boom, you have a revolution with 600,000 dead, 10 odd years later, 9 years later. The second thing for me was reading a 2007 Defense Department report. It was called the Quadrennial Defense Review, and it was from the highest echelons of the Pentagon. And it was basically, they do this every 4 years, and they take a look at the next 25 years, and they say, what are the things that the U.S. military needs to adjust to prepare for? What's the next war we think we might have to fight? So we can make a plan for it, so we can buy equipment for it, so we can train our soldiers for it. And climate change was the entire report. It was focused around what climate change does is it doesn't create the war, but it is a forcing. It's the extra push. If you're on the end of the diving board, it's the thing that kicks you over into the shark-infested waters. And if we don't address climate change, the U.S. military is going to become not an invasion force, but a reaction force that will then have to go in to all these hot spots where climatological destruction is taking existing religious tension, existing ethnic strife, existing class divisions, and it's pushing them to the point where they become open conflict. And then the U.S. military was saying this like brazenly and straight up at the same time that the Bush administration was saying climate change doesn't exist. And so when I looked at those two things like in parallel to each other, I said, wow, okay, so I'm definitely going to trust the generals over trusting the Bush administration, although, you know, it's always good to question the generals. And I just began reading and thinking, as I realized that we were unable to build a strong enough anti-war movement to take down the existing wars we were in, I began to think about the next wars we haven't started yet. And I felt that it was more important for the limited amount of energy that I have to put into, you know, bringing my skills into the climate movement to help upgrade its ability to build a mass movement powerful enough to win, such as it is. So one of the things I did was, you know, I got involved in specific pipeline battles. I did a little work around Keystone, but really what radicalized me and got me into the current work I do was this campaign called the Shell No campaign. And the Shell Corporation, you know, the oil company, was trying to do Arctic drilling, and they basically bought a significant amount of equipment and were telling their investors they were going to find all this new oil in the Arctic and the Chukchi Sea. And they made a fatal mistake. They decided that they were going to base their drilling fleet out of Portland and Seattle. And they picked the two worst fucking cities for them to pick to keep their fleets at. And so many of us in the community, once we learned that our local city councils, without our votes, had decided to lease parts of our marinas and our harbors to this corporation to do this drilling, we got involved and we did everything in this 6-month campaign, from kicking out two of the port commissioners in Seattle who had supported this and voting in new people, to doing land blockades and stopping Shell stations and trucks and workers from going to work, to paddling out in boats and kayaks and sailboats and blocking the drilling rig and blocking all the associated mechanisms that help them do this drilling. We had people in Alaska fighting. We had indigenous people leading us all up and down the I-5, which is the highway out here, the coastal, across the coastal region. And ultimately this battle, we called it the battle in Seattle, but we called it the paddle in Seattle. Battle in Seattle was in 99. And this all kind of led up to this major crescendo point where Shell was able to get its mega drilling rig, this 400-foot beast of a fucking thing called the Polar Pioneer. They were able to drive over us, literally drove over my kayak and multiple others, and we were all arrested by the Coast Guard. And they were able to get out and up to Alaska, and we thought we'd lost. And then the arrogance of corporations, never underestimate the arrogance of people in power. They were trying so hard to get all their boats up there quickly. And this is a fleet that required like 20 odd vessels to make it happen. They had one vessel that, and this is where like reformist organizing actually can help in radical work later on. They had one vessel that had what's called a capping stack. And it was a new thing with their fleet that they were required by the Obama administration to have. And the idea was that if there was a rupture in their drilling apparatus at the base of the seafloor, much like what happened in the Gulf Coast in 2011, if there was a rupture, they had this big machine that they could drop on top of the rupture and stop it from leaking oil into the ocean. And they were not allowed to drill unless that ship with the cap stack was there. And they had to have an icebreaker as well, right? And they're trying to fit into this window, this like very small time window of like a month and a half where the ice is melted enough where they can do these test drills. And so we know if we can cost the company enough money and we can delay them enough, they can't get up there until the ice sheets start to come back, then they won't be able to do their test drills. And if they don't do their test drills, then they're not able to actually get the information they need to tell their investors, hey, this is worth it. Give us another $100 billion or whatever. And this ship, this last ship that they needed, was hustling up. It was driving real fast up to Alaska, and it hit a sandbar. And and they ruptured like a good 10 feet of the hull, and they had to repair it. They couldn't, you know, just stop. And they didn't have a deep water port. You have to understand, this is capitalism. So like, you know, all of, you see it right now with all the ships sitting off the California coast. Everything's timed perfectly, right? There's a schedule. This ship comes in, it gets refilled, it goes out, and the next ship comes in. And if you get any kind of stoppage in the line, it delays the whole thing. It's like a work stoppage, right? And so because of that, they couldn't go to Alaska and they couldn't go to Washington to be able to fix the ship. They had to go all the way back down to Portland, because that was where the only dry dock repair center. They got to lift this massive boat out of the water and repair the hull, right? So they bring it back. And they're keeping this as secret as possible. And we had some connections in the oil industry, people who didn't like this component of it, and they told us about it. And so, you know, the Mosquito Fleet, which is the group I'm part of, and Greenpeace and a few other, you know, scrappy individuals got together, and we decided to deploy a new style of action in the campaign that we hadn't done before. And so we were able to ascertain exactly when that ship was supposed to leave the dry dock. And the great thing about Portland is it's inland on the Columbia River. So you have to drive up a river for about 4 or 5 hours before you can actually get to the docks in Portland. And over that river is a lot of bridges. And so we found what's called the St. John's Bridge, and we deployed 13 climbers, 13 assistant safeties, and a whole host of support structures and staff, over 50 people, to make this action happen. And we put the climbers over the side and hung them down at like 4 a.m. And I was on the bridge, and one of the first things, I mean, we literally like deployed, we had 4 vans, and we were able to deploy people like just military precision. I was very, very proud. And we're literally like 45 seconds, we're able to stop each van, get out, get to our climbing place, put in the links, get the people over. And within 2 minutes, somebody had driven across the bridge and seen us. And I think what they thought is that like people were committing suicide or something.
Oh God.
And so they like, they straight up like called the cops. And within 3 minutes, there's cops all over the bridge. And I had just got my climber over the edge. And right away, cops run up. He's like,
don't do it. You have something to live for.
Get that climber back up. Get that person back up. And I was like, I can't get him up. He's like, step away from the bridge. I'm like, I can't step away. I'm the safety. And he's like, fuck. And then that began a 38-hour period of us blocking this ship. And the ship tried a couple of times to push its way through, then like just drive through the climbers, you know. And if you haven't seen images of this, please just go Google the St. John's Bridge or look at the Shell No campaign. You'll find it. I mean, we were on Rachel Maddow for like 2 full days, as much as she's a problem. But we were able to hold it long enough that the city of Portland responded. The mayor responded in support and said, we don't want this in our city. We had thousands of people turn out. We had people bringing us food on the bridge, driving up their cars and handing us like food. I had one person try to, this is when weed was still not legal. I had one person trying to like hand over joints in action, like tomorrow. But we were able to make it such a mega issue that it cost the Shell Corporation millions of dollars just on that day alone. And we were able to cost them over $3 billion in one quarter of profits from this campaign. And 2 months later, the corporation pulled its support for doing any drilling at all at the end of the season. And so that was, to me, that was like the greatest victory I've ever participated in my life. And I just remember being on the bridge when that ship tried to like drive under us, and it had to stop and turn around, and the whole city of Portland's watching this failure, you know, like they're just shamed, their pants are down in front of the world, and all these young scrappy people were able to stop it. And so it's, you know, I don't know how much you've like paid attention, like the Shaq 7 mm-hmm. or some of the like the dope ass organizing that happened in the 90s where people like straight up went to jail, but they were able to defeat these massive corporations. It was one of those moments where it's like, holy shit, we can do this. And so then I began to work with a number of people I met through that campaign to develop the Mosquito Fleet, which is we wanted a rapid reaction climate group that could do on water direct action in the Pacific Northwest. We didn't want to just have to call Greenpeace and have them parachute a bunch of folks in, as great as they can be. We wanted people who knew everyone in the community, that we know our ports, we are our waters. This is the Salish Sea, and we take leadership from the communities that have been here for ages. And so we have great relationships with the Tsleil-Waututh Nation, with the Lummi Nation, with Swinomish Nation, with a number of the nations. We've got over 30 indigenous recognized federal tribes here in Washington State, and a number in Oregon as well. And you know, we've worked very closely. We kind of see ourselves as like the, we hope to see ourselves as like the 911 of the climate movement. So when you do all your paperwork and you sue the company and you march in the streets and you make your moral pleas and you do your blockades on the company and none of that works, like, then that's where we come in. And we hope that it doesn't get to that point. You know, we don't like the Standing Rock moment where we wait too long to employ direct action, but we find that sometimes is the thing that is actually needed to put the issue on the map.
I kept you on for a very long time, and I really appreciate that story, but like, and that's really awesome. I remember when this was happening and didn't know all the backstory and the drama about like the 45 second deployment and everything. That's awesome. But I was gonna sort of like close up and ask, so one of the things in my life that's really bothered me for the last 17 years, how did I come up with that number, was the failure of the protests to actually stop the invasion of Iraq. And you've mentioned, like, you know, there not really being a movement around anti-war at the moment. You've mentioned environmental movements, you know, as a thing. And I'm wondering, like I kind of point to the direct actions that were happening when the war started as still relying on this shit that we were fed to us by the baby boomers about the story of how change happens in society, that it's, you get the attention by saying no loud enough, and the people in power will change the way that they administer. And that's the same story that the protests against the Iraq or against the Vietnam War in the US actually stopped the war in Vietnam, which totally decenters like resistance of GIs, which totally decenters the resistance of the Viet Minh and anti, like, you know, the anti-occupation forces there. What makes a movement effective? And, you know, just in 5 minutes, if you could, just kidding. But what makes something enough of a living entity that it has these abilities to call on, you know, you've got your lawyers, you've got your people that do the lobbying or whatever, like you've got, you know, the people who want to call their politician, you've got the people that'll go out in the kayaks, you've got the people that will bring weed and pizzas to those folks. How we build and sustain something around that, around like the climate crisis, which is so looming and terrible and heavy over us.
Well, first and foremost, weed is never a bad idea, but I would substitute pizza for Thai food. I think we've had enough pizza falling asleep in the afternoon meeting. So, but I do think that we're learning this with COVID-19, interestingly enough, but we have to get out of this human-centric idea that we can fix everything. We can't. What does it even mean to fix something? You know, like, life is fluid, things change. Every victory we have is going to be abolished at some point, and we'll have to fight it again, and that sucks. But the sooner we acknowledge that, the more we'll be able to build a better world. But I think that instead of reacting to every bad thing that's happening in the world that we have little to no control over, it's finding what, you know, I picked climate change because I think it's the thing that impacts as many other things as possible. And if you're able, like Naomi Klein has talked about, like, if you're able to address it, you know, systematically, from a place of understanding who's most affected, but yet that we're all affected, is a powerful thing. So you find the thing that you're passionate about that you can do for the long haul. You know, we don't need more tourists in the left. We need lifers. We need people who can do this for 30, 40, 50 years, you know, and take breaks and whatever. I mean, I'm not a big fan of like the, oh, we all need to do self-care. Like, yeah, that's called bathing and eating, and like, you should do those things, like, definitely. But it's, you know, you don't have to like make a cult about it. Like, we can just, you know, we can take care of each other a hell of a lot better. But I think that finding the thing that you are passionate about and that you think makes the most sense, and also maybe is the thing that affects you the most, and then taking the time to find like-minded people. We always say at the Mosquito Fleet, we don't need boat experts, we need good people, and we could teach them to be boat experts. So finding good people and then training together to be ready for whatever it is you're trying to do. I think you have to have an alternative vision of the world you want to see and how that takes place. And I think you really need to learn how to do research and plan and make a strategy. You have to come up with a theory about how you think you win and what that world looks like when you win. And then you walk backwards from that to who you are and where you are right now. And you start developing tactics that can fit into and help support that strategy. And all of it's governed by like a goal, right? It's all governed by a place that you're going, or a, you know it when you get there or whatever. But, you know, to take the time to really develop that stuff before you even get out there and start doing shit. You know, it's fine to go, like, in the beginning when you join the left or you join social movements, it's important to, like, get some experience and some bloody lips or whatever. But at a certain point, you need to step back and, like, take time to strategize. I don't share all the politics of the Sunrise Movement, but I will say one of the things that I'm highly impressed with them is that they took 12 people and they put them in a room essentially for a year, and they read a crap ton of books, and they had deep conversations, and they asked themselves tough questions about how they thought they were going to accomplish their goals. And once they did that, then after a year did they spend any time thinking about what their name should be or what their logo should be, or, like, you know, what social media handles and hashtags they should use. That shit was like way later on. They developed the meat and potatoes. Not the best for our audience, but they developed tofu and the veggies of the work first, and then they went out and the other stuff came. It just comes easily, you know, or not easily, but it comes more clearly after you know what you're trying to do. So I think that's really, really important. I think that we need to take more pauses. I think any movement that's able to balance the morality that brings us to this work, the feeling of injustice that we need to fight, that is a great thing to get you off the couch, but it doesn't keep you standing up. You've got to develop other components of this political work. And there are many movements that we can draw from in the past, and there's many contemporary movements, of course, that exist now. But I do think there's a level of, you know, we're stuck in it because of the internet and because of the way that the media operates. It feels like there's a million different notifications and beeps and texts and things that we have to respond to. And I'm telling you right now, you don't have to. Like, there's a level of responsibility to answer the phone when your comrade calls you. But, like, you can take time to wander in the woods or go hiking or climbing or go to the gym or whatever the things are that you know, you read a book, whatever it is that you are capable of and you find passion in, do those things. It's going to make you a much more well-adjusted human. And to let go a little bit, and this is where I'm not spiritual or anything, but, like, to let go of the fact that you think you're going to fix it. Like, you're not going to fix it. You can make your life and the lives of those you love around you a little bit better by being a good human being and standing for stuff. But I think the more we can acknowledge our weaknesses and we can acknowledge that we're human and it's okay to fail, and that this is an incredible gift we have to be alive. It's a beautiful fucking world that we have here, and that we have to enjoy it, or otherwise we'll forget what the hell we're fighting for. So I don't know. I don't have a great, you know, wrap up answer for you on that, but I do think, you know, take your time, develop a strategy, test it, be ready, you know, exercise praxis, as much as that word is overused, but develop your theory, put it into action, and reflect. Please, God, reflect upon whether it worked or not, and then readjust and start that circle over again. And you can do that. And I have a friend actually that worked for PowerShift for a while that said something really powerful to me that I think is really important. It's, figure out who the hell you're accountable to. You got to have a community or a group of people. It could be your family, it could be your lover, it could be any number of things. But for me, I am accountable for the rest of my life to the people of Iraq and Afghanistan. And I don't do this work out of a place of guilt. That motivated me in the beginning, but that doesn't last very long. You got to do this out of accountability to some people that you love. And I'm not doing this to make up for my crimes in the past. I'm doing this to make a better world where nobody's forced into doing those crimes.
Beautifully put. Graham, thanks so much for taking 2 hours and a half to talk to me.
Yeah, of course. Thanks really for the opportunity.
Yeah, of course. It was my pleasure. And I really appreciate what you said here, and I look forward to sharing it with other folks.
Of course. Thanks for all your work.
If you'd like to support the Final Straw Radio, we much appreciate it. You can visit our website and click the donate/merch button, where you'll find opportunities to make a one-time donation via LibrePay or via PayPal, or where you can make recurring donations via PayPal or via our Patreon, where there are thank you gifts on that Patreon for various levels of donation, including stickers and buttons and zines and t-shirts. You can also purchase those items up at our Big Cartel shop, which is linked there too. If you don't have the Skrilla to be able to throw at us, that's perfectly fine. So ways of supporting us include telling your friends about this podcast, getting in touch with us about ideas, concerns, criticisms, critiques, that sort of stuff, reposting us on social media, or if you live in an area with a community radio station that you'd like to hear us up on, it's pretty easy to get in touch with that station and suggest us. We have a radio broadcasting link on our site where we talk about the stations that already air us around the country, and we also list out pretty easy ways for radio stations to take up our content for free. So if you like the voices that you hear on this show and you want them to filter their way into the lives of other people in your community, that might be a good path. You can also get in touch with us and we'll try to help that process along. Just an organism, not in an organization of peace. Shoveling shit in the belly of the beast. You got roped in on an economic trap. Couple years gone in the blister of sun. And the chain of command doesn't care if you see your mom again. What's the number to a dumb computer? When you come from a place where making a living is making a killing. Shifting through feeds and it's on to the next spot. The destroyer of worlds, I became it on Xbox. I mean it's cynical, son. Why you think Call of Duty donates money to the Wounded Warrior Fund? The last starfighter hovers over Jalalabad. Takes out a target and is home for the soccer game. What have I become? What has war become? Ain't no citizens in this new Rome. Only rigged decks and a box of loaded cards to burn. By the time you learn this rule by few, you're in a green zone. Look at the trap that you've walked into. Look at the trap. But back to the desert, the one not in Nevada. You can be born in Aurora to a Muslim scholar. Children in tribal regions pray for foggy days, cause clear skies bring volleys from worlds away. You will never see a city the same. Only a sociopath remains unchanged. And they wonder why we smoked the weed out. 18 years to build a coffin, 30 years to bleed out. It's an army of one. Group at the top, sending strangers to kill for the love of God. Our daily life predicated on death. The violence beneath sends strangers to kill. There's a new national bird. Its wingspan is 66 feet. The old one's habitats are disappearing. Sorry, bald eagle, you're obsolete. What I am is what I am, and what I've done is what I've done. And I can't run to make right none. Takes more than bleach to clean all of the blood off. More than a protest, more than a ballot initiative. Revolutions allow we trace in the present. From before we were born to the last dead president. You ain't disillusioned, you ain't breathing. Hard to see the forest for the trees when the bushes wanna kill you. This is for the nowhere folks with imperial past. They wrote it in gasoline, all you need is a match. I mean, you need a lot more than that. But a match is a decent place to start. What I am is what I am, and what I've done is what I've done. And I can't run to make right none. This is The Final Straw, and I'm Bursa Goodness.
This show will later be archived at thefinalstrawradio.noblogs.org, and you can email us with questions and suggestions at thefinalstrawradio@riseup.net or thefinalstrawradio@protonmail.com. If you'd like to use any episode for your project or radio show, feel free to do so. Just send us an email to let us know. If you care to, you can send us letters at The Final Straw Radio, P.O. Box 6004, Asheville, North Carolina, 28816. This show is brought to you by Firestorm Books and Coffee. Located at 610 Haywood Road, Firestorm Books and Coffee is a worker-owned co-op in Asheville specializing in offbeat, underground, and independent literature. You can find a catalog of Firestorm's books and zines, plus a full calendar of events up at their website, firestorm.coop.